Hello, you've reached the voicemail of Kelly Walker, Public Relations Coordinator for Focus on the Family Canada. Please leave a message and I will return your call as soon as I can.
Hi, Kelly Walker. It's John Ibbitson calling again. I got your email last week, and I was wondering, because it's kind of important to me to have an opinion from Focus on the Family.
Hi, Kelly. It's John calling. John Ibbitson calling. Sorry about that last message.
I just wanted to tell you that I will be returning home. Hi, Kelly Walker. It's
January
John Ibbitson calling again. 3rd. Regarding my student
documentary.
I'm just wondering if you could
get back to me about that interview.
Phone number you can reach me at right now.
If it's possible, I would like to.
It's
have an interview as soon as possible for my documentary.
I have got some interviews together regarding my student documentary by the end of January. So if you could get back to me with any news, that would be great. Bye.
I don't think there's much different about my lifestyle. I mean, I do all the same things. I get ready for school or work or whatever. I do a bunch of household chores. I come home and, you know, if I'm lucky, I have time to watch some TV or fit in a hobby, and then I go to bed. The only difference is who I wake up with in the morning.
I first met Nick on the set of a movie. It was Dawn of the Dead, and we were both kind of dressed up as zombies, and we had like the gore makeup all over our faces, and we were bleeding, and there was this big storm. It started raining, and they had to cancel the shoot, but they wanted to keep us on set in case the storm stopped. So we had this like 4.5 hours where we were talking to each other, and it was during this, you know, lightning storm, which it doesn't sound very romantic, but it was like really, really pretty to watch because the lightning was making all these weird shapes. And so here we are anyway, two zombies sitting in a parking lot watching lightning, telling stories about our life.
Hi, Kelly Walker. It's John Ibbitson calling again. I got your email last week, and I was wondering, because it's kind of important to me to have an opinion from Focus on the Family, because I feel they have an important view on what the family is. I was wondering if I could do possibly maybe an on-camera interview then, or if I could use Focus on the Family's media, like their website media, their print media, to work as comments in my documentary if I can't have an actual person talk. If you could please get back to me on this maybe by next week, that would be very much appreciated. Thank you. Bye.
In spring 2004, a Colorado-based Christian group called Focus on the Family ran this full-page ad in newspapers across Canada. It ran almost every day leading up to the federal election.
When I first saw the Focus on the Family ad in the Toronto Star, it appeared benign at first, but then looking at it and thinking about it more, I realized that this ad was running during the federal election, and it was quite clearly designed to put out an opinion that was actually an election issue. So they came out pretty strongly in favor of the traditional definition of marriage.
I also interpreted the ad as being hateful, resentful towards, I guess, any family that doesn't that isn't the traditional family.
I think the ads that Focus on the Family put in the papers around the election time last year were despicable. Two women in our congregation were on their way to drop their kids off at daycare when one of the radio ads came on, that talking about a mom and a dad making a family, and their kids were really upset. And most of the ads in the paper you see were pretty white, middle-class folks. So the message was that only a mom and dad and kids are really a family. What does that say to heterosexual couples who don't have kids? What does that say to someone who's lost their husband or wife and so one parent is raising a family? Are they really a family? What does that say about interracial families? I mean, there were many families that were made second-class families by the Focus on the Family.
I don't think this country exists anymore. You know, this sort of blonde, blue-eyed country full of uniform heterosexuality and a sort of monoculture in terms of race, class, etc. And they're, you know, trying to legislate out of existence a huge cross-section of the population that doesn't fit in this picture, including gays and lesbians.
I look at it and like this, it reminds me of Nazi propaganda. It really does. It's sort of like the sea of Aryans behind, you know, the heterosexual couple with their little, yeah, actually the little boy even looks like he's got, you know, little sort of Austrian outfit on.
Many of the right-wing Christian organizations have become much smarter politically, and they recognize that when they expose who they are and say to society what they believe, that it's totally disregarded by society. So they have to hide.
Initially, I wasn't that surprised by it. It didn't really shock me because I'd seen that kind of ad so many times before, and not by Focus on the Family. I just mean by other right-wing Christian groups or other religious groups I had seen produce the same kind of material. But as the day continued, it slowly began to wear on me. Like, and I think it's because at that time I was really happy. I was in a new relationship, and I was really happy to be in. We'd been in a relationship for almost a year then, and it started to bother me because I started to think family is something I may want at some point, and marriage is something I may want at some point, and so. Before, when I had seen those ads, and sure, I might have known that I was gay, I wasn't really thinking about those things. So the ad didn't hurt me as much.
But the little girl's kind of peeking out from behind her father, mm-hmm. So they cut that out. We're gonna have a kiss in every shot.
Yes, we do. We must.
I took it as a personal attack on me. I took it as a personal attack on my relationship with John. I thought it was a denial of our love and our intentions to one another.
In terms of equal marriage, we're talking about the marriage of two adult people who are consensual, who are living in healthy, loving, supportive relationships, and who only really want to be able to be there for each other. And have that recognized by the state and by their families and by their society.
Jeremy was interested in music. He was shorter and skinnier than many of the boys in gym class, a glaring fact that caused him to feel self-conscious. Most of his friends were girls. For some reason, he felt he could relate to them more easily. But he never realized how different he was until the first time someone called him queer. It was like a devastating gunshot wound to his heart. And when the others joined...
Sounds like you're mocking the poor boy.
And then the others... Well, it's not even a real story, so it doesn't matter. And when the others...
Because it was positively phrased, the ad itself may not necessarily be interpreted by everyone as hate propaganda, but the fact that they lead you into their website, and if you go to their website and you see the hateful type of messages that they have on their website, that's actually the source of the hate, really, the resource of hate.
When you go onto Focus on the Family's website, you see all the kind of hateful things they say. They align homosexual behavior with every other immoral act out there. They align it with drug abuse, prostitution. They say that homosexuals are more likely to have a variety of health risks, developmental problems, psychological problems. They're more likely to be non-committal and to have extramarital affairs.
First of all, it is not illegal to be lesbian or gay in Canada. Polygamy and incest and bestiality are all illegal for a reason. That's because there are difficulties around consent when it comes to all of those factors. An animal can't consent. In a polygamous culture, oftentimes the woman's consent is negligible at best. And of course, in an incestuous relationship, that implies a very dysfunctional home. Where, again, consent is something that cannot be honestly given or received.
There's a disclaimer on the Focus on the Family website that says, you know, this website is for informational purposes only. We can't be held accountable for the accuracy of our information. That disclaimer right there just shows you that all of their information could be outdated, that some of it could be lies, that, you know, that nothing that they have to say really has any merit.
It's not unusual that the religious right continue to lie on so many different issues. And so, you know, when they tell awful lies about gays and lesbians in terms of our lifestyle or health, et cetera, I think it brings disgrace to the institution of Christianity and the church. And I think that many people are leaving those kinds of fundamentalist churches because they can't handle the continued discrimination.
So when I first moved into this house, this cross was on the wall in my bedroom, and I haven't been able to take it down, even though I would like to. I can't take it down. It's like when I get a copy of the New Testament, you know, I can't throw it out, even, and so then it just sits in my house forever.
There's no question that the tactics of the Focus on the Family are absolutely pushing gays and lesbians out of the church. I mean, that's one of the reasons why our church started. I mean, we started as an outreach to gay and lesbian people who'd given up on mainstream religion, who'd been driven out of churches. But I think gays and lesbians, whenever these churches speak up, more and more leave the church, give up on God, you know, because of the sins of the church. And what we're trying to do is we're trying to say to people, just because, you know, the fundamentalist Christians or the Catholic Church are discriminating against you just because they're saying that you're not equal or welcomed in their churches, don't give up on God. There is a church that will still welcome you.
Hi, it's John Ibbitson calling again. I'm just calling regarding my student documentary. I was wondering if it's possible if anything could be set up or if you had found out anything for me. If you want to give me a call back, my phone number is...
The fact that down the street from a heterosexual couple lives a gay couple who are married doesn't all of a sudden mean that that heterosexual family is going to fall apart. And that's the kind of scenario that the Focus on the Family groups are presenting, that the world will fall apart, marriages will fail, society will fail, if gays happen to get married. And so what we're trying to say is expand rights, give more people rights. And what they're saying is take away rights.
We get asked a lot, are you going to get married? You know, we're lurching towards our 8th anniversary and all that sort of stuff. And we've always been pretty clear on it. No, we're never going to get married. But nothing could be clearer to me than the right to refuse. Right now I can't refuse to get married.
Marriage isn't necessary. You can spend your whole life with someone and not be married, but marriage is special, and I would like to be married to John Ibbitson.
To imply that those who love differently from how you love are against marriage is a form of hate and discrimination. There's no question about it.
And so for them, this is a fight about homosexuality. It's really not a fight about gay marriage. It's about a fight about homosexuality, because for Focus on the Family, they think that homosexuality is wrong, evil, and sinful, but they don't dare say that. Because to say that outside of their churches, to say that publicly, would really draw the scorn of a lot of Canadians.
What they don't want is that they don't want the normalization, in quotation marks, of lesbian gay relationships, because they don't want to have their children, you know, be lesbian or gay.
Ultimately, parents have so little to do with the actual sexuality of their children. They have everything to do with how their kid makes something out of that sexuality. Is it a positive relationship to sex in the world, or is it a negative one? The parents have a lot to say about that. But actual desire, parents are doing very little on that front.
The reality is, of course, that most gay people were raised by heterosexuals. You know, the idea that somehow gays are more threatening or more prone to any kind of abuse or violence or, you know, perversion in some sort of way is just patently false.
Kids raised in gay and lesbian homes are no less well-adjusted than kids raised in heterosexual homes. The issue isn't the sexuality of the parents. The issue is the loving nature in the home. When love is present in the home, that overcomes anything else. And, you know, we have lots of situations where you have a mom and dad and you have child abuse, where you have mom and dad and kids are treated awful. And so just the presence of a male and a female in a home doesn't mean that the kids are going to be okay and raised in a great atmosphere. It has to be, you know, a loving parent or parents, whether they're male or female or two moms or two dads.
When we decide to have children, we would try to instill in our children all the values that we were raised on or things that we think to be proper, to be right. And we would fully expect that our children would learn from other people, from society, from their teachers, their friends, from neighbors, not just from home, not just from, you know, dad and dad. They would learn from everywhere. They would learn from everyone.
Their solution to homosexuality, which they see as a social evil, is to cure it, and to cure it especially in children. And so they try to protect their children from this evil of homosexuality rather than just recognizing the fact that it exists and being tolerant and accepting of it.
Hi, Kelly Walker.
Yes.
It's John Ibbitson calling.
Hi there, how are you?
I'm all right, how are you?
I'm okay, thank you.
Have you been getting my messages, or?
I have, but we haven't had our, I'm just waiting to hear back from our team here about what our role could be.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just in, there's a couple people I have to go through, so I'm just waiting to hear back from them.
Okay.
Yeah.
So should I continue, like, should I call you again, or should I just?
Mm-hmm. And then I'll give you a buzz back tomorrow.
Okay, I'm in Indiana right now. Did you know?
Oh, are you? I think. Okay, how about you give me your phone number just in case again?
Okay, it is 812-339.
I hope you received the messages from my assistant, Marina. In addition to the response communicated by Marina, we certainly cannot put money towards travel to Toronto for a student initiative. We'd also not be able to invest that much extra time. We trust you understand, Kelly Walker. That's the exact opposite of what she said to me before.
Hate is more defined by the person who is the recipient rather than the giver. Oftentimes, the givers of hate don't even realize that they're doing it. But when you receive that hate and when it actually stings, that's when I think hate propaganda can be defined. That is just something in you that knows that you are being personally attacked for who you are. And so, yes, I think that this ad was, in my opinion, hate propaganda.
The Mom and Dad ad campaign that Focus on the Family ran in the Toronto Star, the Globe and Mail, and other dailies cost over $500,000. On February 12, 2005, Focus on the Family ran this new ad in the Globe and Mail. This time, their political agenda to prevent same-sex marriage was more obvious.
There's no reason why things like marriage should remain the same forever. Marriage is not viewed the same way in societies around the world. So why can't we have a different definition of marriage than some other place or from some other people?
I look at my friends and I see that they're all married now and they're all starting families. And I don't understand why they should be entitled to that right and why I shouldn't be. It doesn't make sense to me. I just want to have all the same things that they have.
I feel that if we're both consenting adults in a relationship together and we're both happy and we make each other happy and all the things that we've done together even, I don't understand how people can look at a relationship together and think that it's wrong. Definitions should change as society changes. It just makes sense that as we become more accepting and tolerant of other people's beliefs, values, that the definitions, that old definitions wouldn't be withheld or maintained. So.